Hello everyone, welcome back to Altium Academy. I'm your host, Zach Peterson, and today we're going to be answering some of your viewer questions about ESD protection on RF lines. Now, in a recent PCB design review for Christoph Schmid, I pointed out that it is probably not a good idea to just use any old TVS diode on an RF line. I'm gonna explain why in this video. Let's hop in and get started. So on a recent 1 minute design review for Christoph Schmid, I pointed out that it is not always best practice to use a TVS diode on an RF line. And the main reason that I pointed out was for generation of harmonics. Now, there were some replies or some questions about this, and I've highlighted a few here on screen. Here you can see from Pleo Maxpool, what if ESD protection is needed? What would be the right approach? Daniel McRae also asks, wondering the same thing as others, how do we protect against ESD on the antenna input while also keeping great signal integrity? These are both really great questions, and you can use TVS diodes on RF lines if they are selected properly and they have certain characteristics. Now, there are some things to watch out for when selecting the TVS diode, as well as you need to understand the nonlinear nature of TVS diodes so that you don't generate new harmonics or intermodulation products, as I pointed out in the design review. So let's hop on the board. I'll guide you through selecting TVS diodes for RF lines. So to get a sense for how to select TVS diodes for an RF line, let's take a look at the situation in question. So here we're considering a situation where maybe we have an antenna and that antenna connects to a transmission line. That transmission line then connects to the RX pin on a receiver. And then somewhere along this transmission line, we have a TVS diode. Now the TVS diode could be unidirectional and then connect to ground, or it could be bidirectional. So which one do we need? Well, in this case, we're just going to assume that we have a simple AC wave that is propagating on the transmission line. And of course that AC wave has positive and negative voltage associated with it. And then there is some frequency associated with it. So of course, because it is oscillating above and below 0 volts, we would want to have the bidirectional TVS diode. Now, if there was some DC offset on this signal, for example, maybe it's oscillating up here like this, then it would make sense to have a unidirectional TVS diode for this RF line. But because typically we're dealing with this sine wave, it oscillates above and below 0, we want that bidirectional TVS diode. So that's our first requirement in general for a TVS diode on an RF line. We want it to be bidirectional. Now, if you're unsure of how these components work for unidirectional or bidirectional TVS diodes, check out the video link in the description. It goes over these components in more detail. Now, when the wave encounters the TVS diode along this line, we have to look at the transfer function or the transfer characteristic of the TVS diode in order to understand how this component interacts with this wave. When we have a curve like this showing the current versus voltage applied on the TVS diode, we generally have a forward bias transfer function that looks something like this. Eventually we get to a forward voltage and then it starts conducting in the forward direction. And since this is a bidirectional TVS diode, we would essentially have the same type of characteristic in reverse. Now there is a second type of diode called a snapback diode. And a snapback TVS diode basically has a transfer function that looks something like this, where it snaps in this direction and then comes back to zero. And similarly in the other direction, basically has a snap like this and then continues down into the negative current direction. Now these two types of TVS diodes can be used for RF line protection if the wave amplitude sits within a certain range of applied voltages. And that range is known as VWRM, or the working reverse voltage. And that is basically this range of voltages from here to here. So this is the range of applied voltages where the TVS diode basically doesn't conduct and looks like a perfect insulator. Now there is a little bit of leakage current, of course. This curve does not ever go perfectly to zero except when the applied voltage is exactly zero. But you get the idea, there's going to be such low leakage current as to be negligible in most applications. So this VWRM value needs to be larger than the amplitude or the voltage amplitude of this wave traveling along the transmission line. So we're going to call that requirement number two right here. This is our second requirement that we want for a TVS diode on an RF line. Next, if you know anything about TVS diodes, then you should know that all TVS diodes have a small amount of capacitance, and that capacitance exists across the two terminals on the TVS diode. So that capacitance needs to be very small. Now, there's a very simple way to understand why this capacitance needs to be small. Now, there's really two ways. The first thing you can do is you can compare this capacitance with the expected capacitance of this line in the region where the signal is occupied. And so if this capacitance is very small, then most of the return current is going to pass into the ground plane through capacitive coupling from the line to ground. And that's exactly what defines the characteristic impedance of this line. So if this capacitance is very small, that creates very small deviation in the characteristic impedance of this line as the wave travels. So we don't want to create an impedance deviation by placing this TVS diode along the line. The other way you can think about this is you can think about the impedance of this path to ground. And we would like for the impedance for this path to ground to be very high. And of course, that's going to demand a very small capacitance on this TVS diode. So that's requirement number three. Next, what is the fourth requirement for a good TVS diode on an RF line? Well, the requirement here for a TVS diode on an RF line relates to the capacitance. But what we would like to see is we would like to have a very small change in capacitance with applied voltage. Now, the capacitance of this TVS diode across the terminals can change with voltage, but we would like it to be very small. We don't want to have a sudden increase in the capacitance when we get to the high or low points along this wave. That's going to ensure that we always have a high impedance path between this line and ground. So these curves showing the capacitance versus applied voltage typically look something like this. If I were to just draw out a graph and then plot a voltage here, they basically look something kind of like this. They have sort of a logarithmic shape, but flipped over. So we want to make sure that change is reasonably small. Typical values for the capacitance that you might find in a TVS diode can be anywhere from picofarads down to femtofarads. So they can be pretty small values. And the higher up in the frequency range you go, of course, you want to ensure that you have lower and lower capacitance. You also want to make sure that this capacitance is stable. So what are some example components that we could use for this application where we need to protect an RF line? Well, let's hop on to Octopart. I'm going to show you the search filters that you need to narrow down to suitable TVS diodes, and we can go ahead and look at some example components in those search results. So I'm on octopart.com. I'm going to search for TVS diode. And of course, when you search for something like TVS diode, you get 50 pages of results, tons of different results that you have to thumb through. So we're going to use the filters in order to narrow down to the results that we want. Now, of course, the first thing we want to do is narrow down to the bidirectional TVS diodes. That one should be pretty clear. Now, you can look at things like the breakdown voltage and the clamping voltage, peak pulse, if you're trying to design to a specific standard or design to a specific withstand voltage. But the main one that we care about for an RF line, particularly coming off of an antenna, is the capacitance. So if you click this Add New Filter button, you will see a whole bunch of filters here that you can select from and that you can use to narrow down to a suitable component. So here I want to select the capacitance option under technical. Now, sometimes it's listed as junction capacitance, but for our purposes, we only see capacitance here, so we're just going to select that. Then I hit apply, and now you can see some of the typical values that we can expect for these TVS diodes. So you can see that the capacitance of these diodes can get all the way up to high picofarads, even into the nanofarads, but it can also get all the way down to femtofarad levels, as you can see here. We have all the way down to 150 femtofarads, or 0.15 picofarads. So let's go ahead and just for fun, select this very last option, and let's see what comes up here. So you can see that we have some options from some well-known manufacturers. We have Nexperia, we have Infineon, we have Eaton, and these come in standard passive component packaging. You can see here, this is a 0603 surface mount component, bidirectional ESD suppressor. So this is exactly the kind of thing that we would need for this application with circuit protection applied to an RF line. Obviously, once you get to here, you can see all the inventory across distributors, you can access data sheets, other documentation, everything else that you would expect in Octopart. You can also access CAD files for a lot of the components that you'll find on Octopart. So that's basically what you need to know in order to select these TVS diodes for RF lines. Thanks for watching this video, everybody. We love getting your comments and questions, so make sure to leave them in the comments section. And if you ask a good question, it just might end up in one of these videos. Thanks for watching again, everybody. Make sure to hit that subscribe button, hit that like button, and of course, don't forget to call your fabricator, folks. We'll see you next time.